Okay, so let us start with the next topic, that is amino acids. So as the name itself suggests, that amino acids will be containing two different type of functional groups. These are the compounds containing two different type of functional groups, that is the amino group and the acid group, that is COOH group, right? Now these are the compounds which are the basic monomeric unit of the proteins, and they are in different varieties form. So we'll be discussing about the different forms of amino acids, their types and their function, and how do they form the proteins, okay? And then we'll later see the different type of different structures of the proteins, right? So it mainly consists of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen, and in some of the cases, in very few, two or three amino acids, we'll be finding the sulfur as well. Now they will be having three amino group, and this they will be having mainly two things, that is R group and the, over here we can see C over here. So this is the amino acid, where this is my amino group NH2 and this is my acid group, that is COOH. So all the amino acids, there are 20 amino acids mainly, all the amino acids which will be, they will be having this general formula, having this COOH group and this NH2 group present on the same carbon, present on the same carbon. And to this carbon, there will be different type of compounds can be associated, different type of compound can be associated. Over here, this is CH2, COOH is associated. Similarly over here, CH2, 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 NH2 is associated, which is basically amine over here, and it is basically the acid. So we'll see the difference between them. Okay, so basically the common structure will be a carbon having attached with the amino group and the acid group at the same time. This is the basic structure, and this are called as side chains. These are called as side chains, and determined by the R group. It is considered as an R group in the side chain. Okay, now amino group lends basic character, while the carboxylic group lends the acid character. Okay, so here it is a bit of mistake. So depending, the amino group is responsible for providing the basic character, that is NH2, okay, because it will be responsible for taking the proton, and hence it is an acid basic group, right? While the carboxylic acid, that is COOH group, will be responsible for giving out the hydrogen proton, and hence it is basically considered as an acidic group, okay? So depending on the group present on them, they are of three types: basic amino acids, acidic amino acids and neutral amino acids. So basic amino acids are those amino acids which will be having multiple amino group. Like normally the all the amino acid will be having single amino group, right? But in some cases it may have more than one amino group, like here the lysine. So lysine, normal it has got one amino group which is present in all the amino acids, but along with that, apart from this, there is one more amino group present over here, due to which the basicity, the basic nature of this amino acid increases, and hence this amino acid will be considered as an basic amino acid. Similar about the acetic acid, normally the acetic group is present, but along with that there is one more extra acetic group present over here in side chain, and hence this acid will be functioning as an acetic amino acid. Okay, this amino acid will be functioning as an acetic amino acid. So depending on the type of group which is present on the side chain, the amino acids can be of two types, that is acetic amino acids or basic amino acids. And if there is no such type of group, either acetic or basic group is present, then it will be neutral amino acid, right? So we have seen the basic amino acids, acetic amino acids and the neutral amino acids. Now there are total 20 different types of amino acids present. Total there are 20 different type of amino acids are present. And what is the difference between all these 20 amino acids? The difference is lying in the type of side chain. Only the difference will be there in the side chain. Otherwise, the main chain, the main carbon which is responsible for having the amino group and this carboxylic acid group will be always remaining same. This carbon is called as alpha carbon. Okay. So apart from this, all the side chains will be basically different in different case of amino acids, right? So here you can see the glycine is the simplest form of amino acid. The glycine is the simplest. You have to note it down. It may be asked in the question. It is the simplest form of amino acid, where the side chain is basically having only a single H group. Single H will be present as a side chain. Other things, carboxylic acid group and amino group is present. This is alanine, where one more CH3 will be there. Okay, the glutamic acid is again a type of acidic, and this is serine, which is basically having HOH group present will be there. Okay, so depending on the type of amino acid side chain, the different type of amino acids will be present. Most amino acids are liver rotatory, where glycine is optically inactive. Liver rotatory means the compounds which will be rotating the plane polarized light in a left direction, and hence they are called liver rotatory amino acids, right? and most of them are basically liver hereditary alaminosis, but exception is the glycine. Glycine would not be having that type of conformation. Three important non-protein amino acids, apart from the 20 main amino acids, major amino acids which are found in the proteins, there are three other proteins, other amino acids as well, like ornithine, citrulline and diaminopimelic acid. These are the type of amino acids which are not found in protein, but still they are important. Like ornithine and citrulline are the one which is responsible for the synthesis of urea. Ornithine and citrulline are the type of amino acids which are non-protein amino acids but responsible for synthesis of urea. Okay, diaminopimelic acid is also one of type of important amino acid which is mainly found in the salival of the bacteria particularly. Okay, now the ionizable nature of the special property of this amino acid is the having this ionization group, ionizable group. Like this NH2 can also get ionized by taking the protons and get converted to NH3+, while the COH can release H and get converted to COO-, right? So here both this group which are present on all the amino acids can get ionized. Either they can get into positively form or they can form negatively ion, right? And because of this, they will be either forming the positive or negative ions depending on the type of solutions in which they are present. They will be depending on the type of solution which they are present or what type of pH is there of the particular solution, right? So the nature of the amino acid may change according to the given solution. The nature of amino acid may change according to the given solution. So here you can see this is amino acid where when basically it is present over here in A side. It is basically positive charge. It is positive charge. Why? Because over here the solution will be acidic. The solution is acidic. Because solution is acidic, what is happening? The H plus is in so high amount, and because H plus is so high amount, this NH2 will be receiving this H plus, and hence it is behaving as a positively charged amino acid. It's behaving as a positive charge amino acid, right? So depending on the pH, over here the pH of the solution is low. It means the solution is acidic in nature, and hence this functional group of the amino acid will be getting the H plus on it, and hence it will be behaving as a positively charged amino acid. Why in this case, when the H plus is basically less, or we can say the pH is positive, or we can say pH is alkaline nature, the solution is alkaline nature, right? So what will happen? This COOH will be releasing out its hydrogen ion, okay, and hence it will be functioning as a negatively charged amino acid, right? So the same amino acid can basically behave in different manner depending on the surrounding solution, and at some point of time it may happen that at particular pH, the amino acid will be having both the positive charge and the negative charge present on the same group, and that is called as isoelectric point. That point is called as isoelectric point, and such type of ion which have got both, this is important, the such type of ions in which the both positive and negative charge are present at the same time, such type of ion on which both the positive and negative charge present at the same time are called as Zwitter ion. So this functional amino acids can form Zwitter ions depending on the type of solution. It's important, right? What is Zwitter ion? The compounds which can have both the positive and negative charge on it at the same time. Okay, now let us see the different type of amino acids. Out of the 20 amino acids, there are 8 essential amino acids. It means that these amino acids are basically not produced by our body. We cannot synthesize them by ourselves. Okay, so we are dependent on our nutrition, all the nutrients to get this particular type of amino acids, like leucine, isoleucine, valine, tryptophan, phenylalanine, lysine, methionine, and threonine. These are the essential amino acids which are to be taken in the diet. Our body will not be able to synthesize this type of amino acids. Arginine and histidine are the semi-indispensable. It means that this young children will not be able to synthesize them, but later on after a particular period of time they will be able to synthesize them, right? Or they will be synthesizing them slowly. So we can say semi-indispensable, or we can say semi-essential, right? Otherwise these are the main essential 8 essential amino acids. So here are the 2 different type of essential and non-essential amino acids. Essential are those amino acids which the human body cannot synthesize from raw material, right? And the amino acids which can be synthesized by human body are non-essential. We are not dependent on the other nutrient source for that. So essential 7 and 8 we can say, and there are 13 number, but 1 in adults and 2 in children are slow to be formed. These are non-essential acids. They need to be present in diet. Threonine, we have all those we already heard in. Arginine and histidine are semi-essential. Threonine, valine, leucine, isoleucine, lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, tryptophan, arginine and histidine. Okay, these are the 8. Okay, glycine, alanine, serine, cysteine, aspartic acid, glutamic acid, aspergine, and glutamine and proline. So these were the differences between the essential amino acids and the non-essential amino acids. Now, depending on the type of side chain they have got and depending on the type of elements they have got, they can be of different types. Like, first of all, let us say neutral amino acids. As I told you, when amino acid will be having both the positive and negative charge on them, and the side chain will not be consisting of any type of functional group, neither it may be acidic, neither it may be basic, then it is called as neutral amino acid, like glycine, alanine. They would not be having any type of acidic or basic nature. Okay, and they are non-polar in nature, right? Because it will not be having any type of substances, any septum, any type of group which is basically polar. Acidic amino acid are the one which will be having the more than one carboxylic acid, or we can say monoamino dicarboxylic. Monoamino in a single amino acid amino group is there, and dicarboxylic acid, matlab two dicarboxylic acid groups, matlab apart from the normal one single which is attached to the alpha carbon, there will be one more carboxylic acid group attached to the side chain, and hence they are called as acidic amino acid. Monoamino and dicarboxylic acid, example glutamic acid and aspartic acid. Basic amino acids are diamino monocarboxylic. It means they will be having an extra amino group apart from the group which is attached to the alpha carbon. Okay, example arginine and lysine. These are the examples of basic amino acids. Sulfur containing amino acids are those which are containing the sulfur. Mainly there are two types of cysteine and the methionine. Cysteine and the methionine are the two types of amino acids which will be consisting of the sulfur along with this other amino acids, right? In the side chain they will be having the sulfur. Alcoholic amino acids are those amino acids which will be having the hydroxyl group present on them, which will be having hydroxyl group present in the side chain. Example, serine, OH will be present here, OH will be present, okay, serine and threonine. Aromatic amino acid, the name itself suggests that they will be containing the benzene ring within the side chain. They will be containing the benzene ring within the side chain, and hence they are called as aromatic amino acids. Heterocyclic amino acids are those amino acids where the amino group and the nitrogen of the amino group is present in ring rather than the chain. Okay, so that N will be basically a part of a side chain. This is only one example, that is a proline. So it's an important thing, right? So heterocyclic amino acids, N is present in the ring. Okay. Now, what are the functions of amino acids? Let us see. The functions, different type of biologically active compounds. Okay, they are responsible for formation of different type of biologically active compounds apart from the proteins, like the tyrosine. Tyrosine is the amino acid which is responsible for formation of thyroxine. Thyroxine is a hormone which is responsible for producing the thyroid, it is produced from the thyroid gland. Okay, thyroxine responsible for regulation the basal metabolic rate, BMR, right? So, and it is also responsible for formation of adrenaline and melanin like hormones, right? So basically the thyroxine is a precursor of these hormones. So although thyroxine is functioning as an amino acid, along with that it is also functioning as a precursor of the hormone synthesis, right? Similarly, glycine is involved in the formation of heme. Heme is a part of the hemoglobin, right? Where it is basically responsible for carrying the oxygen. So glycine is also responsible for formation of heme. Similarly, tryptophan is responsible for formation of vitamin nicotinamide, as well as the plant hormone indoleic acid, right? So these are the different amino acids. Although they are amino acids, but they have got another function as well. They will be behaving as a precursor for the synthesizing of new compounds, right? And on the losing of the carboxylic group of carbon dioxide, amino acids form biologically active compounds. Similarly, there are some other amino acids also which can loses out the carboxylic group and can convert into some specific bioactive compounds, like amines, histamine. Histamine is the one which is responsible for blood capillary, which is responsible for basically the histamine is responsible for even the allergic reactions as well, and functioning of muscles, and even the functioning of the blood capillaries and all that, right? It is also playing an important role in the allergic reactions. So the amino acids are not only responsible for formation of protein, but apart from that, they are also responsible for production of synthesis of new compound, which are basically important for the functioning of a body. Okay, now next part is the protein. The protein was first of all name was given and the discovered by Berzelius, right? So proteins are the heteropolymers of amino acids. You have to keep in mind, it is always heteropolymers. Proteins are never homopolymers. So there are different type of 20 different type of amino acids are there, and they will be getting condensed in a different manner. They will be condensed in different fashion, okay, different pattern, and they can give a diversity of compounds which are basically called as proteins. So proteins are of very diversity in nature because of having different type of amino acids. Okay, and this is basically there's two amino acids joined together with the help of bond. That is, the bond will be formed between the COH, that is carboxylic group of one amino acid, and the NH, that is amino group of the second amino acid. So this bonding will be taking place between the carboxylic acid group and the amino group, and this linkage is called as peptide bond, and this will be associated with the loss of water as well, and hence it is called as dehydration synthesis. It's important. Okay, so the two amino acids come together, condensed with the help of it will be this amino acids will be condensing and forming the protein at a specific site of synthesis called as ribosome. The ribosome will be taking a part in basically forming the protein synthesis. It will be taking place at the ribosome, and it will be also occurring along with the formation of water molecule. H2O will be released out, and hence it is called dehydrogen synthesis. The bond will be formed between the carboxylic acid group and the amino group. Okay, and along with the removal of water molecule. Okay. Now there are two main types of proteins, that is collagen and the Rubisco, which are present abundantly. Collagen is the one of the protein which is abundantly present in the animal. It is the most abundant protein present in the animal kingdom, while the Rubisco is the one which is most abundantly present in the plant kingdom, or we can say in the biosphere. Rubisco is the collagen is a type of connective tissue, is a basically fibrous tissue, right? White fiber. And the Rubisco, ribulose, biphosphate, carboxylase, oxygen. It's a specific type of protein responsible for fixation of the carbon dioxide during the photosynthesis, which will be studied in your physiology chapter. Okay, so that was about the proteins. Okay, now the proteins are how they are forming structure. So they are basically, suppose this is the hypothetical structure of the protein where the four amino acids are there, N1, N2, N3. So this will be containing glutamic acid, tyrosine, cysteine and serine. This is all the amino acids will coming together, forming a bond between this. Over here you can see CO and NH. The bond is formed between the CO and NH. This CO and NH, right? And this is called as amino. This bond is called as peptide bond. Okay. The tyrosine is basically, see here, it is having this amino group, right? Sorry, this is having this alcoholic group. Okay. And this cysteine is having SH group, sulfur is present, okay. And this serine is also having alcoholic group, OH is present. Glutamic acid is having the acidic group, COOH is present. So this different type of amino acids will be coming together to form a linear chain, And this linear chain is called as primary structure of protein. Okay. So that was about the amino acids and their structures. Now next is structure of protein. So when the amino acid is forming the protein, the first sequence of amino acid which is formed on the ribosome is called as primary structure of protein. So whenever these ribosomes are basically carrying out the synthesis of proteins, they will be condensing the different amino acids in a linear sequence, and this sequence will be called as primary structure of protein. So primary structure of protein determines the specificity. It will be determining the specificity of the protein, but does not make the protein functional. It is non-functional protein. You have to keep it in mind. No protein is basically functional until unless it is basically attaining the shape of secondary tertiary structure particularly, right? So it is not a functional protein, right? A functional protein contains one or more polypeptide chain. A sequence of amino acids in the chain determines whether chain will be bent or fold. So here the sequence what is formed on the basis of the type of amino acids which are basically getting lined up in a particular sequence. And this sequencing will be responsible to determine where the folding will take place and where the bonding will take place. So these all things will be basically determined by the sequence of the proteins. Okay. Next is the secondary structure. Okay. So the primary structure is the first one, is a very primitive form of, well, not primitive form, but it's a very nascent form of protein sequence. Okay, which is developed from the the ribosome. Once the protein primary structure is formed, then the depending on the amino acid sequence, this different amino acid will start forming the bonds within them. And these bonds will be mainly made up of, will be basically carried out by the formation of hydrogen bonds. Okay. So this formation of hydrogen bond will take place between this specific type of amino acid and will lead to a formation of specific structure, which is called as secondary structure. A secondary structure can be of two types. It can be a keratin. It can be a coiled structure, as like it is called as helix, which is mainly found in the keratin of hair, or it can be pleated. It can be helix or it can be pleated sheath. This helix will be the coiled structure, while the pleated sheath will be basically a flattened plate-like structure where the intermolecular hydrogen bonds are taking place. Here you have to keep thing in mind. In the case of pleated beta sheath, the intermolecular hydrogen bond is taking place. It means that the hydrogen bond is basically formed between two adjacent molecules of
two adjacent molecules, right? Or we can say two adjacent molecules of proteins. While in the case of coiling, in the case of helix model, in the case of helix structure, the hydrogen bonding will be taking place within the same molecule itself, within the same molecule itself, within the same chain itself. Okay, so let us see them. So the H and the NH group of the amino acid is bonded to the O and atom of CO2 three amino acids away. A protein which is entirely helical is keratin. Keratin is the protein which is entirely helical. It does not have any beta protein sheath and all that. Okay. The other type of secondary structure is called as beta protein. Let us see them. So here it is the helical structure. It is a helical structure. It is a helical structure where the structure is basically the bond is formed between the molecules only. And this beta protein sheath where the hydrogen bond is formed between this intermolecular proteins, right? So this is the beta protein structure with the helical structure which is mainly found in the keratin, while this beta protein sheath which is mainly found in the different type of fibers particularly. Okay, and next is tertiary structure. Once the second structure is attained, the polypeptide chain will start binding and form folding extensively and forms a compact globular proteins. Now they will be folding according to the formation of bonds. So mainly during the secondary structure, the bond which were formed were mainly the hydrogen bond. That was the weak force of attraction. While in the case of tertiary structure will be formed by the formation of the strong bond. And this strong bond will be basically taking place, that is a covalent bond. This is the covalent bond. So here the covalent bond will be formed between this S and S, and H is basically forming a disulfide bond. Similarly here also, the bond is formed between the amino group and the carboxylic group. Again, a peptide bond is formed, right? Or hydrogen bond is formed. So these bonds will be formed between hydrogen and oxygen. This is bond which is formed with S and S. So here we can see different type of interaction which will be consisting of hydrogen bond. It will be also consisting of covalent bond, and it will be also having this hydrophobic interaction. Hydrophobic interaction, it means that the amino acids which are hydrophobic in nature will come together and will be forming a specific region where the water molecule will be prevented for its entry. And that force of attraction which is responsible for the coming together aggregation is called as hydrophobic force of attraction. Okay, so these are the tertiary structure. Most of the proteins are functional at this structure only. Most of the proteins are functional at this structure only. Mainly the different enzymes which are functional in nature will be having this protein's functionality. The tertiary structure is so important for the function. Okay, so that was about the tertiary structure of protein. Later on, it may acquire the quaternary structure as well. So here you can see the first primary structure was a clear sequence. The primary structure was simple sequence. This is my primary structure. Now, this primary structure has got converted into secondary structure due to formation of hydrogen bonding between them. And then it formed tertiary structure where you can see this is the basically helical model, and this is somewhere you can say plated model, okay, plated sheath as well. So all this will be coming together in the tertiary structure. And the last one is the quaternary structure. The quaternary structure is the structure where the different tertiary proteins of tertiary structure, that means the different globular proteins, may come together, and a unit of proteins will come together to form a functional protein. Example, hemoglobin. So hemoglobin will be consisting four units. The hemoglobin will be consisting 4 units. Example, histone proteins. Histone proteins will be consisting 8 units, right? Histone octamer particularly. So here, when the multiple units of protein comes together to form a functional protein, it is called as quaternary structure. It is called as quaternary structure, right? And next is types of protein. So that was about the structure of protein and the amino acids. We are done with that. Now let us see the types of protein depending on their attachment, what all things are basically found along with them, right? So first of all is a simple protein. The name itself suggests that it is made up of only and only amino acids. No other any group or no other any type of element or substance is associated with them. So they'll be composed of only amino acids. They are not basically coagulated by heat, because they will not be having much different type of layers, right? So they will be globular mostly, and they are soluble and not coagulated by heat. Okay, not coagulated by heat. And the other one is basically the big size. The proteins which are of big size will be solubility will be less, coagulation will be more. Okay, fibrous proteins have long molecules and are insoluble in water. Example, keratin and skeletin, all that, right? So simple protein can be of two types, that is conjugated and non-conjugated, right? And the conjugated proteins. The conjugated proteins, the binding of a simple protein with a non-protein called as, so whatever, and sometimes what may happen for the proper functionality of the protein, for the proper functionality of the protein, there it may bind with another group in another group, and that is called that another group which is basically binding to this protein, but which is not a protein, which is not a part of amino acid, right? Which is not made by amino acid. It's called as prosthetic group. What does it call it? You call it my prosthetic group, right? What is prosthetic? Prosthetic group is that part of protein which is bound to the protein for its functionality, but it is not a protein in nature. It is not a protein in nature. So that is a prosthetic group. So the conjugated proteins are as follows. It would consisting nucleoproteins, where the prosthetic groups are nucleic acid. The prosthetic groups are nucleic acids. So nucleic acids are actually DNA and RNA. They are functioning as a, they are bound with the proteins, hence they are called as prosthetic group. Okay, as a protoamines. Metalloproteins will be where the metals will be functioning as a proto, where metal will be functioning as a prosthetic group. Example, hemoglobin. Chromoproteins, prosthetic group is the pigment. The different type of pigment will be present for the as the prosthetic group. Example, heterochromes. Phosphoprotein, prosthetic group is phosphoric acid. Examples, casein of milk. So this is a different type of prosthetic group present in different type of proteins. Lipoproteins, where the protein prosthetic group is lipids, right? So glycoproteins, prosthetic group is carbohydrates. Example, mucins. So what are these, let us say, different functions? There are a lot of proteins. There are different diversity of proteins in across the world, across the organisms, and even in the single organism as well. There are a lot of functions which they carry out, but right now we'll be discussing some important functions of important proteins. We'll be giving with examples like collagen. So collagen is responsible for forming the intercellular ground tissue substance. So between, it will be responsible for formation of connective tissues, will be formed with the help of this, right? Next is trypsin. So trypsin is a type of enzyme. Trypsin is a type of enzyme responsible for digestion. So the enzymes, the proteins can also function as enzyme. Collagen is a structural part, structural protein, right? So it can function as a structural part. Second, it can also function as an enzymatic part, right? Third one is insulin. Insulin is a hormone. Now see, the same type of, same nature of substance has got different functionality, different type of position or different type of function role to play in a particular organism. So it can also function as an insulin, function as a hormone, right? And it can also be an antibody. Antibody is a that type of protein which is responsible protection of our body from the any foreign particles. So whenever a person is getting infected, or a person is supposed to get infected, what will happen? The antibody will be released, and it will be released in a high amount so that the foreign particle which is getting inside the body can be removed. Can be removed by different manner. That is antibody. Then receptors. These proteins are also present on the epithelial cells, particularly where they will be receiving the stimulus. They will be receiving the stimulus which is basically sensed by the organism. So for sensing purpose, there has to be some sort of receptors present in the body, and these receptors are made up of, again, proteins. These receptors are made up of proteins. These receptors can be smell, test, hormone receptors, etc. And the last one is GLUT1, that is glucose transporter proteins. So these are the type of proteins. This is one of the examples. There are a lot of transporter proteins which are present on the surface of the membrane, because whatever we eat has to be get into the cell because for the metabolism. But until and unless it does not get, it won't be possible for us to get the energy, neither the energy nor the growth. So the food substance which we eat will not be that much big, will not be that much small, so that it can directly enter into the membrane. So there has to be some specific type of proteins which are responsible for their transporting across the membrane, and these are called as transporter protein. So GLUT4 is also that type of transporter protein which is responsible for movement of the protein across the membrane. So these are the different type of proteins which are seen in the function. Okay, so these are the main functions. These are the representative functions. Apart from this, there are a lot of other functions as well, and there are a lot of variety of proteins found in the living system, right? Next is glycoprotein. It's again a conjugated form of protein where the carbohydrate is associated with the protein. So as we have already seen in the carbohydrate part, that it is responsible for recognition. So the antigen which are present on the body is also associated with the specific receptors present on the RBC. So they will be responsible for providing the recognition, cellular recognition. Histone proteins are the one proteins which are responsible for DNA wrapping. So in a single amount of a single cell will be consisting of around 2.2 meter of DNA in human body. So there's a lot of big DNA present in a single small cells, in a particular in the nucleus. So this DNA has to be wrapped. This DNA has to be wrapped and properly packed so that it can be sent to the, it should be basically packed and wrapped properly so that it can be stored in the nucleus properly, right? So this histone proteins will be responsible for storage of the DNA by wrapping the DNA around it. Okay, the histone octamer will be providing the support for that. Antibodies, as I told you, that they are the defense protein responsible for protection of our body from the external organisms. Even the snake venoms basically has got toxins within them, like even some toxins like ricin, which are produced from the castor, even some bacteria which will be produced from bacterial toxins.
So these toxins are highly poisonous in nature and that can kill the organism. And these toxins are also type of proteins. Okay. So that was about the proteins, the function, the structures and the varieties. Okay. So let us start with the lipids. Okay. So lipids are also containing the carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. But over here, the oxygen is always so less about compared to the carbon. The number of oxygen molecules will be so less compared to the carbon and hydrogen particularly, right? So lipids are particularly insoluble in water. Because of this, they are called, they are non-polar nature, because they are non-polar nature, and they are also called as oils. Okay, so lipids are the one which are water insoluble, and they are also called as oil, and they are non-polar nature, and they contain fatty acids which may be saturated or unsaturated. So let us see what the lipids are made up of. So here we can see the structure of lipid. So lipid is actually made up of two things, that is fatty acids and glycerol. Okay, so first of all, let us see what is of glycerol is. The glycerol is a tricarbonous compound. It's a compound containing three carbon and three hydroxyl group. Over here the hydroxyl group is not so let me draw it for you. So here it will be having three carbons, and the carbons will be having hydrogen associated with them, and will be having OH. This is my glycerol. Now this glycerol will be having OH group. It means it has got alcoholic group. Now this alcoholic group will be getting associated, will be getting associated with this group, that is acid group, fatty acid. Now let us see what is fatty acid. Fatty acid is again, it's a chain, that is R. R can be any number of carbons, that is 16, 14, 17, 18, 19, it can be anything. It is basically having the terminally present COOH, that is acid, that is carboxylic acid. So because it has got the carboxylic acid group at the terminal, it is called as fatty acid. So this is the carboxylic acid group plus this alcoholic group. These both are combining together here to form a bond, Okay, and this bond is called as, I have already seen glycosylic bond. What is that? That is glycosylic bond. Okay. So now how this fats are formed? So this glycerol will be basically reacting or will be associated with the different type of fatty acids. So here this is one fatty acids, this is second fatty acid, this is third fatty acid. All these three can be same, all these three can be different, all these three can be of different types. So depending on the type of fatty acids, and again there will be one more compound which will be called as the phosphorus group or something like that. So there are a lot of varieties of lipids are formed because of the different possibilities of the combinations, right? So these are the fatty acids, and now they are non-polar in nature because all the fatty acids will be having the CH2. They will not be having any hydroxyl group, right? They will also having the hydroxyl. There is also not a hydroxyl group, so no hydroxyl group is present over here, and hence they are basically totally, and neither any charged molecule present is present over here. Hence it is totally non-polar in nature. They are totally non-polar in nature, and hence they are water insoluble, and hence they are called as oils as well. Right? Now fatty acids. What are fatty acids? I just told you. This is an organic acid with a hydrocarbon chain ending in a carboxylic group. Now the fatty acids can be of two types. It is saturated and unsaturated. We have already studied in class 10th that what is saturated. So saturated is that type of amino acids where only single bond is present. Where no double bond is present. So saturated fatty acids are those fatty acids where the only single bond is present, no double bond or no triple bond is present, right? So example, palmitic acid, the 16,6 and the stearic acid 18C. The melting point of lipids is high, majorly the one which is basically unsaturated nature. So the saturated fatty acids will be basically having a high melting point. Here the example of palmitic acid and the stearic acid. The palmitic acid will be consisting of the 16 carbon and the stearic acid will be consisting of the 18 carbon. Okay. This is general formula, CnH2nO2. Okay, this is the general formula of the fatty acids. Okay. So you can see the number of oxygen is so low. Compared to carbon. Now, unsaturated fatty acids are those which will be having the at least one or more than one double bonds are present within them. So here these are the one which will be having the double bond present within them, right? So example, the 18 carbon unsaturated fatty acids are oleic acid, linoleic acid and linolenic acid, have 1, 2, 3 and double bond respectively. This is oleic acid where the one double bond is present, linoic acid where the X is number of double bond fatty acids, is more than that. Arachidonic fatty acid has 4 double bonds, so it may be of different numbers. It may be the number of double bond may be vary. Okay, and when it is single double bond is present, is called as monounsaturated fatty acid. Monounsaturated, MUFA, MUFA. And when the more than one unsaturated fatty acid present, is called as polyunsaturated fatty acid, that PUFA. Okay, so it's important. The fatty acid, number of double bonds, number of single bonds. Okay, now let us see the saturated and unsaturated fatty acid difference between them. So saturated fatty acid does not possess any double bond, they possess a double bond in their fatty acids, right? All carbon atoms are fully saturated. It means that all the carbon atoms have got hydrogen. Carbon atoms are unsaturated in the region of double bonds. Straight chains. Now one thing more important, the saturated fatty acid will be always having a straight chain. They will not be having any type of bond, band and like that. But in the case of unsaturated fatty acids, the chain bonds are, because having the double bond, they will be having showing a kink. They will be bending. Okay, so if they have straight chain, the chain bonds at the double bond, the chain bands over here, it has to be written bands, the chain bands at the double bond. So wherever there is a double bond, suppose this is a structure, this is normal structure. Okay, now suppose here is a double bond, what will happen at this particular area? There will be a change in the branching, right? So they will be forming a band. There is a band formed. Okay, so what is band? Band is that it the single chain will basically get diverted. It will be basically at the position of double bond, where double bond is present, right? They are solid in ordinary temperature. You have seen the unsaturated fatty acids are basically saturated fatty acids are solid, like the animal product like ghee, butter, cheese are the saturated one. Are the saturated fatty acids which will be having high melting point and will be solid at the ordinary temperature. They are liquid at ordinary temperature, like you have seen the oils which are basically the cottonseed oil, the sunflower oil, all these are basically are liquid at room temperature, right? They are lower melting point. You will be able in the winter season, the ghee will be getting solidified, but the oil will not be getting solidified. Why? Because the oil has got higher melting point. So lower melting point. Animal fats are mostly saturated fat, as I told you. Plants fats are generally unsaturated fats, right? They increase blood cholesterol. Unsaturated fats lowers the blood. This is something important. The fat, saturated fatty acids like the plant animal products like ghee, butter, cheese, all that, they increases the cholesterol. They increases the blood cholesterol, while the unsaturated fatty acids like they will be decreasing the blood cholesterol. Hydration has no effect on saturated fats. Hydration converts the unsaturated fats into saturated. So if basically the unsaturated fat which is having a double bond is undergoing a hydration. Hydration means the addition of hydrogen to the given compound. So when an unsaturated fatty acid is undergoing hydration, what will happen? It will get converted into saturated compound. It will get converted into saturated compound. Okay. So example, the formation of the dalda ghee, the formation of the vanaspati ghee is basically nothing but the hydration of the vegetable oil. So essential fatty acids are absent, essential fatty acids are present in the case of unsaturated fatty acids. The essential fatty acids are absent, which means that we have to basically, the body synthesize them. They are not much affected by the exposure of air. Saturated fatty acids, only exposure to air, they tend to solidify. Okay, unsaturated fatty acids. So next is the mono, di, or triglyceride. As we have seen that the fats, lipids are basically made up of two parts, that is glycerol and the fatty acid, glycerol and the fatty acid, right? Now let us see what are these mono, di, and triglycerides. So oils rich in unsaturated fat, as we have to see, the oils are mainly the one which are present having high amount of fatty acids, unsaturated fatty acids, and low melting point, and having the low melting point. On hydrogenation, if we hydrogenate them, it means that if we add hydrogen to them, the unsaturated fatty acids becomes saturated. And this technique or this phenomenon is basically utilized by the for the formation of different type of vanaspati ghees, right? Next, other one, even the waxes which we basically observe in the different type of compounds, like even the honeybee wax is also there, the wax which you basically make the candle is also there. So there are different type of waxes available. Some are naturally found, some are synthesized. So waxes are another class of simple lipids. They are also type of lipids of a long chain fatty acids with a long chain alcohol. So here no basically multiple number of fatty acids will be there. A single fatty acid will be bound to the single long chain alcohol, and the main role is to protect the plant, particularly or animals, from the external entry of the animal or any organism, right? And they form water insoluble coatings on the hair of the skins of the animals and stems, leaves and fruits of the plants. We have told you they will be forming a cuticular strata, or basically a water impermeable layer, so that water will not be discharged and water will not be lost out in the sensitive area, okay, where the water is required. So in that scarcity, the water has to be retained properly. B-Vex is also formed from palmitic acid and the maryyl alcohol. Maryyl alcohol and palmitic acid are responsible for formation of B-Vex. It is basically hexacolized valmate secreted by Verkhovi. So these are the glycerol, as I told you, CH2, 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 and triple OH, right? And these are triglycerides. So a single glycerol having one carbon, second carbon, and third carbon. Fatty acid party, but as I told you, it will be having COOH and then CH, 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 right? Then phospholipid. Next will be started with the phospholipids. Phospholipids is nothing great, it's not big deal. So R1 will be there, and this is the R1 similar to that. R2 will be also there, similar to this, that. But third one is the R3. Instead of R3, what is we having? We are having the phosphoric acid, PO4. Okay, PO4. And to this P, we will be attaching different type of acids. We will be attaching the different type of acids. And such type of generic compound which are giving phosphate and lipids are called as phospholipids. What we call them? Phospholipids. There's the cholesterol. Cholesterol can derive from this cyclic structures where it will be functioning in different forms, positively and negatively, we will be discussing. Next is phospholipids. So phospholipids, when I say, so it's a straight chain compound of glycerol. It's a straight chain compound, as I told you, fatty acids and phosphoric acids. So phospholipids will be having glycerol, will be having, this is the glycerol along with that fatty acid 1, fatty acid 2, and the phosphoric acid. Over here the fatty acid 3 will be not there, it will be having phosphoric acid, and to this phosphoric acid there will be, it will be binded to the another group. Okay, so group of, in this only two fatty acids are attached to the glycerol molecule, and the third hydroxyl group of glycerol is acidified with the phosphoric acid instead of fatty acid. So here the bond will be taking place between the phosphoric acid, the H3PO4, and this CH3OH. That bond between the alcohol and the acid is called as esterification reaction. We can say ester bond, right? So here the ester bond is formed. Now common phospholipids are lecithin and cephaline, which are mainly found in the human cells, right? Amphipathic molecules having hydro. So this phospholipids molecule also called as amphipathic molecule. Now what is amphipathic molecule? The amphipathic molecules are molecules having both. Note it down. The amphipathic molecule are the molecules having both the water loving and water hating part on the same surface. So it will be not on the same surface, but on the same molecule. So molecule containing both the water hating, that is non-polar part, and water loving, that is polar part, present in the same organism, in some compound, right? So basic constituent of biomembranes. It is the main which is found in the biomembranes. Cephaline is found in the brain and acts as an insulation material for nerves and acts fast to the blood coagulation. And also acts as a blood participant in blood coagulation. So cephaline is also one of the important factor type of phospholipid which is responsible for the insulation for brain, and is also responsible for the coagulation of blood. Lecithin takes a part in cell permeability. Lecithin takes a part in osmotic tension and the surface conditioning of the cells. Lecithin is the one type of protein which is responsible for the cell permeability. It regulates whether what to come out and what to come inside. Okay, osmotic tension and surface conditioning of the cells. Now this is the structure of phospholipid molecules, that is R1, R2 are fatty. This is R1 is fatty acid, R2 is fatty acid, and now here the R3 is basically connected with the phosphoric acid, and this phosphoric acid is in turn connected with the different functional group, and according to this it will have its name. Now this phospholipid, as I told you, it has got the amphipathic nature. Amphipathic nature means that it will be having both the compounds, that is hydrophobic and hydrophilic part. So it will be containing both the hydrophobic and hydrophilic part on the same compound. So here you can see these are the dark stained molecules, and above this is the water. So this darkly structure, dark stained structure are basically nothing but the hydrophobic part. They are hydrophobic part, due to which the water will be remaining outside only. The hydrophobic part. These are the surface heads, and which are responsible for facing the water, which are responsible for facing for water, and hence they will be called as hydrophilic part, we can say water loving part. Okay, and they are polar in nature. So here we can see there are two parts. Okay, so here we can see there's a head, tail. This is the one surface of the membrane. Now this is my water. So whenever the water is entering, it will be getting exposed to the surface of water surface. So head will be getting So this head has to be basically in such a manner that it will be able to cope up with the water. So it will be hydrophilic. It will be hydrophilic. Here also the hydrophilic part. That is the same part will be having hydrophilic. Both the part will be having hydrophilic. While the chains or the tails which are present in between this membrane, hydrophobic or hydrophobic. So that suppose by chance any some cells which get inside the body, so maybe then it would be basically not allowed inside because the membrane is hydrophobic in nature. Membranes will be hydrophobic in nature. Okay. So next is hydrophobic. You got it. Amphipathic water, non-polar tails, polar head group water, choline phosphate polar group head, glycerol fatty acid. Yeah, again we can say phosphatidylcholine. This is the one. The choline is again a type of molecule which is present along with the phosphate. So here the glycerol and two fatty acids are present which will respond for formation of phospholipids, phosphatidylcholine. Next is glycolipids. Having a huge reduce, the glycolipids are cerebrosides and ganglioside. Okay? So they are mainly found in the cerebrosides and the ganglioside. Composition: the glycolipids contain fatty acids. By name itself suggests fatty acids, alcohol and sphingosine and sugar. It contains the fatty acids, alcohol, sphingosines. These are type of sugar and sugars. The glycolipids are components of cell membrane. The glycolipids are component of cell membrane, particularly in the myelin sheath of nerve cells. The function of water function membranes are composed of lipoproteins. Lipoproteins occur in the milk of egg yolk and chromolipids. Chromolipids are those lipids, pigments such as carotenoids, example vitamins and carotenes, all that. Okay. Next is derived lipid. What are derived lipids? Derived lipids are from the lipids. The lipids will be, some of the lipids will be functioning as the precursor and they will be responsible for the formation of new compounds which are called as derived lipids. Okay. So the first one is the sterol. First one is the sterol. So lipoproteins can, okay, so first is the sterol. Sterol is the one not straight chain compound. It will be having a cycle of compound. It will have a cyclic compound. So sterols will be having cycling compound which will be made up of fused hydrocarbon rings and long hydrogen side chain, right? So it will be mainly the example cholesterol, right? So cholesterol in animals only. Cholesterol is present on humans only. This is something what you have to keep in mind. Cholesterol is also the precursor of hormones such as progesterone, testosterone, estradiol, and androcortisol. There are different type of hormones which are also synthesized by the cholesterol. So it's important to basically store it. Next is the prostaglandin. Prostaglandin is also in such fatty acids which function as a messenger substance between cells. They function as a messenger substance between the cells. So suppose the cell is basically creating some problems, right? The message should be gone to the either to the gland, either to the heart, either to the brain. So accordingly the function should be carried out. So this message has to be taken care of by the prostaglandins. They will be functioning as the hormones or receptors. Hormones, huh? Now the circulating blood. This prostaglandin is circulating blood and also responsible for providing the immunity. A prostaglandin regulates the production of acid in stomach and stimulates the contraction of smooth muscles. The smooth muscles which are present in the body, like the prostalis movement and the gastric movement and the prostalis movement and the peristaltic movement and also we can see the uterus contraction during the parturition. So these all movements are basically taken care of by the prostaglandins. Analgesics like aspirin inhibit prostaglandin synthesis. There are some chemicals or drugs which like aspirin which inhibits the synthesis of prostaglandins, right? Cholesterol, it is also responsible for pain, right? So cholesterol, absorption of fatty acids, formation of sex hormones, they are mainly responsible for absorption of fatty acids, sex hormones and formation, and vitamin D and bile formation. Now fatty acids, the organic acids, as I told you, with hydrocarbon chain ending in carboxyl groups. Okay, so saturated fatty acids and unsaturated fatty acids. This is done, I think. Okay. So that was about fatty acids. So up to this, fatty acids were there. The fatty acids are done. Now we'll be starting with the nucleotides. Okay. So let us start. So what we have done in the fatty acids, let's revise fatafat and amino acids. We have done with the amino acids and the fatty acids. In the fatty acids, we have done what are fatty acids and what all things they are formed of, glycerol and the fatty acids, okay, and their types, the functions and the properties. Okay, these are things what we have done. Now let us start with the nucleotides. Okay. Nucleotides are the complex molecules which are part of the information transport system in the cells. So
As you know that the, every organism has to have the information molecule which is present in the form of DNA and RNA. So this information has to be transformed from generation to generation and from generation to generation and also from one cell to nucleus to the different parts of the cell to carry out the functions. So this information has to be transferred, and for this transformation molecule, either it can be DNA, it can be RNA. But this DNA and RNA, these are nucleic acids, these are information molecule which are also basically formed by the monomers called as nucleotides. These are formed by the monomers called as nucleotides. Okay. So these are, first of all, they are responsible for information molecule, the basic units of nucleic acid, and also they are responsible for participating in the energy transfer system. So they are the one which are responsible for providing the energy for the reactions, metabolic reactions, like forming, giving the ATP, GTP and all that, right? So these are the one which are responsible for providing the energy and responsible for the formation of nucleic acids. So the main constituents of nucleotides are carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen and phosphorus, right? So these are made up of mainly the cyclic nitrogen base pairs, which are three are the main components. The components are the sugar, that is pentose sugar, which is containing 5 carbon. It contains nitrogen bases, which are of two types, that is purines and pyrimidines. Nitrogen bases of purines and pyrimidines. Purines again consists two types, that is adenine and guanine. So you have to note it down. The purines are of again two types, that is adenine and guanine, while the pyrimidines are of again two types, that is cytosine and thymine. In the case of RNA, it will be thymine. Instead of thymine, it will be uracil. Okay, so you have to note it down. Purine, adenine and guanine, and pyrimidine will be thymine, uracil and the cytosine. So apart from this nitrogen base, they will be having a sugar. That sugar is ribose or deoxyribose. Ribose is, both are the pentose sugar containing the 5 carbon, and will be a type of ketose sugar. Will be a type of, no, it's not a type of ketose sugar. So it will be having the, it can be have a ribose, it can have ribose or deoxyribose, and it will be having furanous structure. It will be having a furanous structure. The nucleotides are thus called the ribonucleotides or deoxyribonucleotides. So in the case of DNA, it will call it deoxyribonucleotides, and in the case of ribose, it calls it ribonucleotides. We'll see what the differences are. So as you see, RNA is having a ribonucleotide and DNA has got deoxyribonucleotide. So here we can see the purines. These are the two type of purines, that is adenine and guanine. These are the cyclic ring having the nitrogen and carbon present within them, nitrogenous ring, and hence they are called as nitrogen base pairs. Okay, and these are the pyrimidines, three type of pyrimidines: uracil, thymine and the cytosine. Uracil is only present in RNA and thymine is present in DNA. So instead of thymine, the uracil is taking place in it in the DNA. There's the only difference, presence of the thymine, presence of the methyl group. So in the case of thymine, this is methyl group is present. In the case of uracil, the methyl group is absent. So these are the main differences between them. Okay, now the structure, when we say the structure, the nucleotide consists of mainly three things. So what all three things are there? First of all, let us say this is nitrogen base pair. Nitrogen base pair, and this is the pentose sugar. The pentose sugar is the ribose sugar. And this ribose sugar attached with the phosphate. This phosphate can be 1, 2 and 3. This phosphate can be 1, 2 or 3. If it is 1, it is monophosphate. 2, it is diphosphate. 3, it is triphosphate, right? So all together is made up of, it's called as nucleotide. If this phosphate is absent, only this part which is present in the square, is called as nucleoside. So this part which is present in this square, is called as nucleoside. Okay, so this will be called as nucleoside. While the whole part is called as nucleotide. So you have to make sure there's a difference between nucleoside and nucleotide. Nucleoside is the nitrogen base plus pentose sugar, while the nucleotide is nitrogen base, pentose sugar and the phosphate. This phosphate can be monophosphate, diphosphate, triphosphate, right? Okay. And now this nucleotide will be consisting of a high energy bond. It will be consisting of a high energy bond. Here you can see this is written. It's a high energy bond here. So whenever these bonds are broken down, it's called as phosphoester bond. Right? Because it is basically taking place between the two alkali group. Okay, two phosphate, phosphoric acid. Okay, so we can say phosphoester bond is present over here. And this phosphoester bond is basically broken down to release around 8 kilocalorie of energy per mole of the hydrolysis. So one mole of the breaking down of nucleotide phosphoester bond can release 8 kilocalorie of energy. So it's so important for us serving as a energy resources, okay, in the cells. Okay, so that's about the nucleotides. Now we'll see what type of bond they will form and how they are basically responsible. Now function of nucleotides. So first of all, they are responsible for nucleic acid formation, and they store energy in the form of high energy phosphate bonds, as I told you. and this nucleotides are formed, this nucleotides which are responsible for formation of ATPs, responsible formation of energy, release of energy, or responsible formation of nucleic acids are formed during the photosynthesis and respiration. So they are also formed during the ATPs particularly, which are formed, ATP is a type of nucleotide, right? So these are formed during the photosynthesis and also during the respiration. And they are also acting as a coenzyme, like nicotinamide and riboflavin nucleotides. These are the type of vitamins, they are all type of vitamins, okay? Nucleotides act as a coenzyme of oxidizing enzymes. So these are the ones which are also responsible for carrying out the respiration. They are helping in respiration actually, right? So we can say they are also responsible for acting as a coenzyme, as we have already seen what the coenzyme is in the case of proteins, right? Now nucleic acid, the first nucleic acid was basically, there are two types of nucleic acid, that DNA and RNA. First it was discovered by Mesher. Okay, the nucleic acid is a giant molecule having a variety of functions. The variety of main function is basically to store the information and to transfer the information. The main, the storage of information, and second is to transfer the information and to control the different activities carried out in the cell. So there are two types of major type of nucleic acid, that deoxyribonucleic acid, which will be called as DNA, and ribonucleic acid, which is called as RNA. DNA is found mainly in the nucleus, but also occurs in chloroplasts and mitochondria. This is something we have to make sure, you have to keep in mind. So they will be found in the nucleus, but also apart from the nucleus, they will be also found in other organelles such as chloroplast and the mitochondria. It is a genetic material and contains all the information needed for the development exist. As just I told you, it is the one which is responsible for having all the information for the transformation information and for the development and the regulation of the cell and the body. Okay, so RNA occurs as genetic material in the viruses. In some viruses, the RNA can still function as a genetic material. Apart from viruses, the RNA will not be functioning as genetic material in anyone, in any organism, right? So this is something which is important. Now the nucleotides, the nucleic acids are linear polymers of purines and pyrimidines nucleotides, right? As I told you, nucleotides are linked serially by phosphate groups. Let us see how they are linked, which is the, okay. So let us see the first form of DNA, that is BDNA of DNA. The DNA and RNA are main two types of nucleotides. The DNA will be consisting of ATCG, that is purine pyrimidine, as I told you, already done with this. And the DNA is basically made up of two chain of nucleotides. DNA is made up of two chain of nucleotides, whereas RNA is made up of single chain. Not always, but sometimes it can be of two chain as well. Okay, so the RNA can be single or two, but DNA will be mostly the double chain compound. Okay, let us see. So first of all, the structure of DNA, the most accepted structure of DNA is BDNA, and other forms of DNA is also found, that is ADNA, ZDNA is also observed. Okay, but the major one which is found in the body is basically BDNA. The BDNA structure was given by Watson and Crick, and this is called the Watson Crick model. James Watson and Francis Crick, they basically discovered this model on the basis of the data which were collected by Rosalie Franklin's. Okay, and she collected the X-ray crystallography of the samples, and according on the basis of the data, these people carried out the research and given a descriptive model of the BDNA, you know? And this DNA is basically called double helix model. It's called a double helix. It means that it will be forming a helical structure like a staircase. Here you can see. So this is forming a staircase like structure. One helix is this, and the other one is this. Other one is this. So this is called as double helical structure, right? So this is a double helical structure, and each helix consists, each strand consists of three things. That is this is the sugar, pentose sugar, and this is the phosphate. This is the phosphate backbone. So the backbone will be made up of two things, that is the pentose sugar and this phosphate group. This phosphate group and this pentose sugar, these are the main backbone of this strand. And the nitrogen base, this adenine, thymine, guanine, will be basically projected towards the center. This nitrogen bases will be projected towards the center. Okay. Now here you can see deoxyribose. Why you can see deoxyribose? Because over here, the second carbon, the hydroxyl group was there in the case of ribose. But here, the hydroxyl group, out of this hydroxyl group, the oxygen is removed. When the oxygen is removed, it is called as deoxy. And hence, it is called as deoxyribose nucleic acid. Deoxyribose nucleic acid. Okay. So, this was about the structure of, a brief structure of DNA. We'll be studying again a more structure, detail about this structure in the next slides. Okay. So, as we have seen, this is a double helix. It's an antiparallel strand. Antiparallel strand means that the strands that are present over here will be in a manner that one will be going in this direction. Here we can say, suppose this is the one. Here are two directions.
Suppose this is the one strand that is going from 5 dash to 3 dash, and this is the second strand that is going from 5 dash to 3 dash. So here it is 5, here it is 3. So they both will be anti-parallel. They are anti-parallel nature. It is called as anti-parallel nature. So 5 dash represent, the 5 dash means it is the terminal carbon. It is a terminal carbon to which the fifth carbon, it's a terminal carbon to which the fifth carbon, where the phosphate group is present, where no further bonding is taking place, where no further bonding is taking place. While the third terminal is representing the carbon where the hydroxyl, 3OH, the hydroxyl group is present. To make sure, it may be asked the question, the 5' part, 5' terminal of the 5' terminal of the DNA will be consisting of the phosphate group, while the 3' will be having the hydroxyl group, that is OH group, right? So that was about the antiparallel structure. Okay, here you can see this is the pentose sugar, and this pentose sugar is basically forming associated with this phosphate bond, and these are the two different type of nitrogen base present between them. Okay, and these are basically projected towards the center, forming a bridge like structure, forming a staircase like structure, right? This is the staircase like structure where you can see this is the backbone, ribbon like backbone. And the stair and the nitrogen base is oriented between the center, towards the center, right? So that was about this. So anti-parallel, we got it. Backbone is formed by the sugar and phosphate sugar chain. I just told you, nitrogen bases are projected more or less perpendicular to this backbone, but faces inside. This is what we have seen. Now they have got complementary base pairing. What is complementary base pairing? So it is basically always whenever there is a A adenine. So just opposite to adenine, there will be always thymine. Opposite to arginine always, so there will be always thymine opposite to adenine. So purine will be always opposited by the pyrimidine. So adenine will be always having the thymine opposite strand, while the cytosine will be having the guanine as the opposite strand. Okay, so this is something important. Now this nitrogen base pairs are connected with the help of hydrogen bonding. The nitrogen bases are connected with the help of hydrogen bonding, like the C and G. The three hydrogen bonds are present between the C and G. It's important. The three hydrogen bonds are present between the C and G, while between A and T, that is adenine and thymine, only two hydrogen bonds are present. So your question may be asked, depending on the how many number of hydrogen bonds are present, how many number of bonds are present, so you should be able to do that. So in the case of CG, in the between C and G, three hydrogen bonds are present, while in between A and T, two hydrogen bonds are present, right? And each strand appear like a helical staircase. Each step of ascent is represented by a base pair. Now this, each one is called as base pair, right? So this is one base and this is second base, so both are basically together forming a pair, and this pair is called as base pair. And DNA is basically measured in base pair, like it can be 10 base pair, 20 base pair, 1000 base pair, 10,000 base pair. So length of DNA is also measured in the base pairs, right? So at each step of ascent is represented by a pair of bases. At each step of ascent, the strand turns 36 degree, and one full turn helical has steps of 10 base pairs. The rise per base pair is about 3.5 angstrom. Now we can see, this is the one where basically it is twisting, right? So here every base pair, basically every helical from here to here, this is the whole 360 degree turn is basically taking place over here. So in this particular part, in this particular one turn, there will be 10 base pair, right? So 360 degree is basically turn which is taking place in 10 base pairs. So according to this, between two base pair, the every base pair will be basically getting twisted for 36 degree. Okay, and the distance between two base pairs will be 3.4 angstrom. The distance between two base pairs will be 3.4 angstrom, and the total length of the one total turn, the length of total turn is the 34 angstrom. This is something we have to keep in mind. This is the one loop here, one turn from here to here, right? So this turn is consisting of 10 base pair, and its length will be 34 angstrom. It will be consisting 10 base pair. So distance between this base pair will be 3.4 angstrom. It will be 3.4 angstrom. So is that clear? So that's done. Okay. Now, so apart from this, what we have seen the structure of BDNA, where the main thing what we have seen is the sugar and phosphate forms the backbone. Nitrogen base pairs are basically projected inside. The nitrogen base pairs are basically connected with the opposite strand by hydrogen bonding, where the C and G will be having three bonds and A and T will be having two bonds, right?
and these bonds are these strands are running anti parallel to each other and complementary to each other. That is, A will be always complemented by the T and C will be always complemented by G. Okay, and apart from this, we have seen that each turn will be consisting 10 base pairs, and 10 base pairs will be having total length will be 34 angstrom, and between the distance between two base pairs is basically 3.4 angstrom. Okay, that was about the structure of DNA. The detail structure of DNA will be studied in the molecular biology, that is the chapter in your class 10th. Okay. Apart from this, we have seen the purine and pyrimidines. So there was a scientist, Ergen Shergov gave a particular rule according to which the purines and pyrimidines will be always equal. It means that A plus G is always equal to T plus C. We can say A is equal to T and G is equal to C. This is something which is so clear, which is so important. Okay, so all the species will be having a specific ratio. The base ratio of A plus T by G plus C may be vary from one species to another. Keep in mind, but it is constant for a given species. So whenever the human being we take, whether from any part of the world, they'll be having a constant ratio. But if you suppose we compare the ratio of AT by CG with the other animal and with the human, so it will be different. Okay, so it's a specific characteristic of a particular species. Deoxyribose sugar and phosphate components occur in equal proportion. Again, as the number of sugar, the number of same number of phosphate components will be there. RNA is usually single-stranded, but sometimes it may be present as a double-stranded as well, like in the reovirus. Okay, so this is something we will be discussing. You would have discussed in classification as well. So RNA does not follow the Chargaff's rule. This is something you have to understand. The RNA will not be following the Chargaff's rule. Okay. Next is the RNA types. So RNA are of again different. DNA is done. The DNA's function is to store the information, to transfer the information from one generation to second generation, and also carry out the formation of RNA and to carry out the functioning of the regulate the functioning of the all the parts of the cell by transcribing the DNA by giving out the RNA. Okay, so now let's see the second one is the RNA types. So RNA, as we know, it's nothing but ribonucleic acid. Okay, it will be having almost same structure, but instead of thymine it will be have uracil, and it will be mostly single stranded structure, and it may form a loop, it may not form a loop, and it would be mostly single stranded, sometime it may be double stranded, and it does not follow the Chargaff's rule. These are the points which we have already studied. Right, now let us start the types of RNA. The majorly there are three types of RNA. Apart from this, there are a lot of other types as well, but mainly we have to discuss about three types of RNA. The first one is the messenger RNA, which is also called as mRNA. So it is mainly synthesized in nucleus. And it is responsible for carrying this information of the amino acid sequence. Like which amino acid sequence, which will suppose the protein is to be synthesized, then what will be the sequence of amino acid in that sequence in that protein? So it is responsible for defining. It is responsible for determining the sequence of amino acid in protein. It is important. Write it down. Okay, so what is the function of mRNA? It will be responsible to determine the sequence of amino acid in protein. Right? And this is the smallest type of all the RNA. So mRNA, next is the tRNA. tRNA is transfer RNA, and it is the smallest type of total RNA. Out of total RNA, it will be 10 to 15% of RNA will be constituted by the transfer RNA. It is the one which it's called as transfer RNA. By name itself, we can understand that it is responsible for transportation. It is responsible for transferring some substance from one place to another. What does it do? During the protein synthesis, when the protein is being synthesized at ribosome, what is happening? It will be synthesized because of amino acids has to be taken at that particular place. So this transfer RNA will be carrying an amino acid to the ribosome, to carry out the synthesis of protein. So that's the function of tRNA. So what is tRNA? tRNA will be carrying the amino acid to the ribosome during the synthesis of protein. And its structure, if you observe it, it looks like a clover leaf like structure. Okay. And this is the smallest step of RNA. Next is the ribosomal RNA. That's the 80% of total RNA. Will be constituting the ribosomal RNA. Now this over here, the RNA will be functioning as a structural unit. So it is responsible for formation of ribosome. Make it note. It's important. It's basically important for formation of ribosome. So it will responsible for formation of ribosome. Okay. So ribosome are made up of two components. That is protein and RNA. Which RNA? This is ribosomal RNA. Okay. There are different types as well. We will discuss in the cell structure.
Okay, that was about the RNA type. Here we can see that instead of thymine, we have got uracil over here, and over here it is my polynucleotide strand of RNA. So that was about the nucleotides is done, nucleic acid is done. In the next lecture, we will start with the enzymes, okay, and what all enzymes are, how does it function, and what are their types and all that. Okay, that's all. Bye bye.